First of all, I would like to thank the three speakers for the interesting and very exciting debate and presentation that they have made so far. Well, it's very impressive to see the different angles of gender and development that they have raised, the varieties which give to all of us new direction on how to include gender in the development agenda. Well, discussing about gender is far from being new. It has been discussed in several times. It has been discussed for several years, but unfortunately, we are in almost in 2016, and we still record a high number of women in developing countries who are lagged behind in terms of access to resources, lagged behind in terms of economic opportunities. And many women in developing countries face different barriers in their daily life. And this constraint starts first inside of their households, where several social and cultural norms deprive them of autonomy inside, but also outside of the houses. When you go to the labor market, these women, they still face a number of barriers. Women are less likely to get decent and productive jobs. In the political arena, also women are disproportionately represented, as it has been well expressed by Elizabeth. The world has experienced the MDG, and the goal number 3 has expressed the importance of empowering women, social empowerment, economic empowerment, and political empowerment. Today, we are moving to something different. Here we are. We are talking, all of us, about sustainable development goal. And once again, women is incorporated. Gender equality, gender equality in terms of economic, social, and social norms and political aspects. Well, here I would use these opportunities. You know, this is a good occasion for me to ask some three questions to our three speakers. And these questions are going to be related to the hot topic, which is sustainable development. My first question is about education. Well, the MDG has provided quite positive outcomes in terms of primary schooling, right? In many developing countries, we have roughly equality in terms of access at primary schooling. And even sometimes, we have more girls than boys at primary school. So I believe maybe in the next coming years, we will make some study on how to promote boys at the primary school rather than girls. But unfortunately, at the secondary school, it's unfortunate that the MDG hasn't really go deeper into promoting girls at the secondary school. So we expect that the SDG will try to fill this gap. So my question is here. Well, we are talking about promoting the number of girls at the secondary schools. But at the same time, we record a high number of girls that are dropped out from school for many reasons. First of them, I can cite like forced marriage, and also access, the lack in terms of access to infrastructure, mainly sanitation or toilets, which is a big issue in many rural areas in Africa, but also in India, for instance. So forced marriage can have different causes. It can be due to poverty, like parents, they have many children and they would like to get rid of some of their girls. It can be also a way to get some money through a bride price. But it can also be cultural norm. So from the cultural aspect, it might be difficult then to remove them by 2030, which is the deadline for the SDG. So to what extent do you think that by 2030, the world could achieve a gender equality at the secondary school in the circumstances where we have forced marriage and a lack of good and decent infrastructure. My second one is related to access to finance. Again, the MDG has done good job in terms of promoting microcredits, promoting microfinance in order to promote entrepreneurship for women. Well, if you rely on the World Bank statistic dating back to 2014, it seems that entrepreneurship is where, in sub-Saharan Africa, entrepreneurship is where women are the more active outside of the agricultural sector. So we don't have this issue of gender gap in terms of entrepreneurship in sub-Saharan Africa. But the problem is, many of these women entrepreneurs in sub-Saharan Africa, they are micro and small, they run micro and small businesses. And they are more likely to operate informally, and they are more likely to be focused on low added value goods. So these women, they face many issues. And one of them, it is access to big finance. We should go beyond the micro and microcredit and microfinance. Now, the sustainable development should go beyond looking how these women entrepreneurs can have access to loans and credit from the financial sector, from the banks. So, given your reading and your understanding of the sustainable development goal, do you think that this aspect of the development of the financial sector and the inclusiveness of women in the financial sector is carefully taken into account? And then I am ending to this point also related to access to finance. When we take the group of the women entrepreneurs in sub-Saharan Africa, many of them are entrepreneurs by necessity, but not by opportunities. So necessity because they are facing constraints in the labor market. So when they have this microcredit, it's a good opportunity for them to open these firms. But the problem is, if these women, they may not have the sufficient entrepreneurial skills and ability. So if they have access to this formal financial sector, they may not provide good results. So here comes the question of efficiency. To what extent the reducing the gender gap or promoting women to have access to the formal financial sector can be efficient? I think I am unfortunately constrained by the time. Thank you.
So good afternoon, my name is Anne Michels, I'm from the University of Namur, and I'm also working on the gender and development project here at UNU-WIDER. Okay, I have some slides, but I think I have to go very quickly, so I'll skip some. Okay, I was going to tell that I really liked a lot the three presentations. Obviously, I could not say something different, something else about Jean-Philippe, he's my supervisor, so. But no, I really liked the paper a lot. I think I'm not going to give you a summary, I'll just go to the comments. Okay, one important assumption that he is making, and I think that it's a bit too strong, is that the legal system is gender neutral. And I think this is really not the case. There's a very interesting study, new study by Biterna on El Salvador, where she shows, in fact, that police, the legal system, the judicial system, is not gender neutral at all. She shows that men who are accused of severe forms of domestic violence, they are excused by the police, by the judges. It's how men behave. It's like this. While women, on the other hand, who have done nothing illegal, they can go for decennies to prison because they didn't act as mothers. They are accused of fetal homicide. They didn't do anything illegal, but they are mothers. They should be mothers. They should act like this. So I think there are really some constraints also on the legal system. It's here in Europe, and you have exactly the same in developing countries. Another remark, I think that is also for Professor Fox. I'm not sure, but about economic opportunities. I think that economic, it has been shown, not I think, that economic opportunities do not necessarily lead to improved outcomes. In fact, Munshi and others have shown that there might be no effect in when women have an increase in their income, there might be no effect on their bargaining power, depending on the links they have to their family and their home community. And if they really depend on those kinds of networks, then they see no effect at all, because for them it would be really, really costly to give up those networks, and so they cannot act against those social norms. Also, there has been shown that even when you have an increase in agency, women don't always perceive this as something positive. There is this work on migration in Morocco where they show that there is male migration. Women have, because of this, women have much more agency in the household decision-making power, but they perceive this as something very, very negative because they are told you act as men. So they get really stigmatized by their society, and they don't like this at all. You were speaking about the garment sector. I think there's a new study by Zaki Wahaj who shows that indeed you have an increase, women working in the garment sector, they have an increase in the agency, they can take more decisions within the marriage. But again, this is not perceived as something which is really positive, because there's again a stigma associated also to working outside of the family home. So this is perceived as something not always positive. I'm going very quickly, sorry. I really liked a lot your presentation, and I think you have touched, Professor, you have touched on so many subjects that there's not a lot left to say. You are speaking about migration. I think indeed that migration is a major phenomenon which will certainly change the role of women. It has been shown that there's an impact on gender roles, even if there's some mixed evidence. It has been shown that migration to Western countries seems to have a positive impact on gender norms, but that if you take, for example, the example of Egypt, where migration has been mainly to Gulf states, it has had a negative impact. And again, there's work of Munshi who shows that whether it has a positive or a negative impact, again, depends on family networks. Then there has been shown that there's an impact on education, on the health of children, and this is especially positive for girls. But I think what needs to be done a lot more work is on female migration. In fact, it has been shown that, there are different results. Some show that women tend to remit more, others show that men tend to remit more. Then on health and education of children left behind, there's not a lot of work, and what is mostly done is descriptive. We don't know what is happening. Is this because of a gender bias in the migration decision? Is it that households that send women away are completely different than households that send men away? Is it because men and women depend differently on their networks? So I think there's really a lot to be learned and a lot of interesting things to be done, and I would like to have your opinion on this. Also, you have on migration, you have, for example, there are some studies on the Philippines, but I think they're not very conclusive. You have now women who leave their family, and there's an impact on the adolescent girls who are left behind and who have to take care of their brothers and sisters. So it's not always so positive, I think. And just for the last speaker, I think what you are suggesting is very similar to the Beeman and Duflo paper. And so I just wanted to ask you if you also see an impact on the number of females who are enrolled in school. You see you have this repetition rate, but do you have also on the number of females enrolled in secondary education and the numbers of year of education? And then I think, for me, it's quite similar to Duflo, so it's really interesting. I was just wondering what you think about this quota system in the political system, but also in education. Thank you very much.
Thank you for good remarks and good questions. I think we could have a quick comments from Louis and Elizabeth. Jean-Philippe escaped already, he had to catch a plane. And then I'm also saying that unfortunately there will be very little time for questions. I don't know if...
I asked... And then we speak at the end.
Okay, fine. I think we can take two questions here from the audience. no audience questions. Okay. Okay, I'm sorry about that. So you catch up the speakers while we are walking out. So if we can get a quick answers, thank you.
Okay, I don't know, does anybody want that? Everybody's leaving. Okay, quick answers. Number one, will the sustainable development goals be achieved? I don't know, not in every country in every way, but I think we have to be optimistic. Certainly, it's possible to achieve improvements in female enrollment in secondary school, but obviously it's going to take improvements in other areas as well. And I think economic transformation will be a key element of it. I think I agree with Anne that the evidence on whether earnings leads to increased empowerment of women is mixed. It first of all depends on how it's measured, whether it's measured by bargaining power in the house, whether it's measured by behavior, or whether it's measured by how a woman feels. So do they feel empowered or do they act empowered? And so different people use different measures and they get different outcomes. The evidence from South Asia is positive. The Blattman's evidence from Uganda, for example, is not positive. And there's rather mixed evidence from Munchi and his team. Migration, more work to be done, yes.
A very brief answer, one-liner. This, my research does complement to Flo's work. Bottom line, females play an important role and it's very crucial in bridging the gender gap. Thank you.